we are rolling.
Alright,
it's January 9, 2003.
Mr. Ramsey Clark, former Attorney General of the United States. Ramsey, I guess the best way to get started is to tell us when your LBJ's path first crossed, and what your impressions were, and
I heard of him long before I met him, because he was quite a feature in our household.
I'm sorry, please, some reason you had to drop out the sound, so from the top again.
Okay. I heard of Lyndon Johnson long before I met him as a youngster, because his name was a household feature where I was raised. The first time I remember hearing him was...
Sorry guys, I apologize. Just get changed spare batteries for that mic, or is it just cut for a second?
Now you want to start all over?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
Okay.
We've got your introduction, so just go ahead and jump straight into the answer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I heard of Lyndon Johnson for a number of years before I ever actually met him, because he was quite a legend in our household as a very young man. First time I can presently recall actually hearing of him was when he first, I'm sure I'd heard of him before, but it's the first time I can remember, when he first came to Washington in the House in 37 or whenever it was, I can remember the folks saying, well, something like Lyndon's arriving in Washington on his own. I remember we were driving down Constitution Avenue, and I was sitting in the back seat, just a little kid, and someone in the family said something like that. I remember in the summer of 40, the next time I can really remember his name coming up, we'd gone to Alaska, mother and dad and I. My sister stayed home just for a vacation. And dad had a little, even in those days, a little portable radio, and he was sitting up late at night listening to election returns from Texas. He was a lawyer in the government by this time. Listening to hear if Lyndon Johnson won the race. The first time I remember meeting him was during the war. We'd moved back to Washington during World War II, which to my generation's the war. And it was hard to find people to do work, because we were mobilized in a terrible struggle. And my folks asked me to, they were going to a party at the Johnson House over on, it's close by where we lived, it's a mile or so, 32nd place or first place, something like that, Washington. It was a Sunday, and they needed somebody to churn the ice cream churner, so I was recruited to do it, which was fun, because if you did that, you got to, when they pulled out the dasher, as we called it, or the mixer, you got to lick off the ice cream before anybody else got to it. Yeah, so I ground the ice cream out for them. Might have done it more than once. I can't really remember. The next time I remember seeing him, there was no real interaction between us on any of these occasions. but the next time, I was a student at the university. It was 1948, and I think it was 1948, it must have been. And then we went down to a little rotunda in Austin there, where Lyndon Johnson was going to announce his candidacy for the Senate. And I remember he had on, I'd been in the Marines, but I was still, say, 20 years old by that time. Well, I became 20 that year. And I remember he had a big old white Stetson. He took it off and I said, I throw my hat in the ring. And he saved this big old hat. I thought, wow, that looks like a $100 hat, you know, being thrown out like that. Then I remember driving down with Speaker Rayburn and Ray Peeler, who was a close friend of mine who lived in Bonham. And the Speaker's home office in Bonham there was in Ray Peeler's father's store upstairs. We were driving down for the funeral of Lyndon Johnson's mother. I remember the Speaker saying, when a man loses his mother, he loses the best friend he'll ever have. I remember observing Lyndon Johnson at that time. Then beginning in 61, I came into the government as an assistant attorney general. And of course, Johnson had been elected, sworn in on January 20th. Somehow or other, I got in position liaison, means of communication, Attorney General Kennedy.
I apologize, I need to cut, there's a sound issue, it's doing it again. Stand by.
Shot size, so maybe can I do it?
Yep, okay. Stand by. And camera is set.
I'll back up a little bit. In the 1950s, I'd returned from finishing law school to Texas, and spent the 50s practicing law there. I get to Washington at least once a year, and probably toward the end, three or four times a year. I don't recall seeing President Johnson during that period, although I think I probably saw him when he came through Dallas a time or two, because my uncle, Robert L. Clark, who I was practicing law with, was close to him and would see him when he came to town. And I've got a feeling that I saw him at the airport or in the office or someplace. But beginning in 61, I was an assistant attorney general, and Robert Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson had the need to communicate on a variety of things, and those that pertained to the Department of Justice, Bob Kennedy designated me to be a liaison, you might say. I guess that's the best word. It wasn't much fun. The then Vice President, Lyndon Johnson, felt strongly that as majority leader, he was a person with real power that he could affect, and he wanted to affect. I mean, for all of his realism, which he never abandoned him in, for all of his practicality, he was an idealist. I mean, this was a man who believed you could end poverty. You know, how glorious, and who believed you could end racism. You can't get more idealistic than that, more wonderfully idealistic, but he always worked at it in a very practical, hard-headed, realistic way. So he said that he should have, because he'd made this sacrifice, giving up power as majority leader for what Jefferson called a splendid misery, the vice presidency, that he shouldn't lose his prerogatives in recommending to the president nominations from Texas. And most of those, or many of them, fell into the Department of Justice, United States attorneys, federal judges, things like that. Ralph Yarborough is now the senator, and in many ways they shared values, they really did, but politically they were rarely allies, although I think always open and friendly personally. But Senator Yarbrough felt that it was his right. That was, this has been the tradition, not a very wholesome tradition, but nevertheless the tradition that the senators from the state would have the privilege of making recommendations, because the Constitution gives the power to the president to make to appoint civil officers and judges. And we went back and forth for 3 years on U.S. attorneys, and it was tough negotiating. They would agree on some. I think they agreed on people like Sarah Hughes to be a federal district judge in Dallas, and some there were real disputes. There was the president, Lyndon Johnson, then vice president, was very anxious to put a Mexican-American on the federal judiciary, the first. There were some Hispanic surnamed people in history, but there was no real Latin American. And there was a very distinguished lawyer, terrifically good lawyer, named Ronaldo Garza from the Valley, from Brownsville. And probably clearly the best single qualified Hispanic lawyer in Texas for the job. And the president was dying to put him on, because he thought it'd be good for the country and good for Texas, you know. Unfortunately, Ronaldo Garza had something to do with Alan Shivers in a race. As I recall, Yarbrough and Shivers had run against each other for governor and things like that, maybe. Anyway, Yarbrough was very much opposed to Shivers' supporters, and we finally worked it out. President Johnson was unbelievable. I remember Garza came up, and it was a rainy, rainy night, and we went up to the vice president's little office in the Capitol. And Garza may have been to Washington before, but I'm not sure. He was really overawed. I remember I'd taken him to a place called Ciro's, and we had a stake that night to try to fortify him. Nearly got drowned getting up to the Capitol. Of course, it was after midnight, and the vice president was just getting started in his day's work, because that's about the time he, I mean, he started early, but he went so long. And he embraced Garza. This was after we'd finally had a breakthrough, and the president was going to nominate him to be a federal district judge. In fact, I think maybe he was coming up for his hearings. I'm not sure. And he embraced him, and he said, I want you to be the best judge there ever was. He said, I want you to always think, what is the just thing to do? And when you go off the bench, I want people to say that man must have been inspired by Jesus. Poor old Garza, his knees were just wilting. I'm supposed to be inspired by Jesus, and I've got to be the most just man in the history of the United States judiciary. He turned out to be a terrific judge. That was a tough time. A funny thing happened. It became kind of a legend in our family during that time. I was seeing the vice president a whole lot, but I was seeing him on kind of difficult, almost sometimes mean-spirited business. And I'd have to go listen to what Yarbrough said, and I'd have to go listen to what Bob Kennedy said, and I'd have to go listen to what President Johnson said, and they weren't all saying the same thing. So one Saturday, or maybe it was a Sunday, I was working. And Lyndon Johnson always loved children. He was terrifically good with children. So somehow or other, Georgia, my wife, and our son Tommy got invited over to the vice president's house. It was summertime, and to go swimming. And later that evening, I was told when they were leaving, the vice president was asking Tommy, whether now Tom, 50 years old, a lawyer in the Department of Justice, said, well, did you have a good time today? And Tommy said, it's the second best day of my life. And the vice president said, only the second best day of your life? What was the first best day of your life? And he said, well, when Granddad took me fishing. He said, "Well, I'll see to that." I said, I want to give you the best day of your life." And thereafter, whenever he would see Tommy, he said, "Have you had any more best days?" He said, "Is that still the second best day of your life?" I remember even at my swearing in, and as Attorney General in 1967, of course, Tom was there, young Tom. On the first occasion when this swimming episode occurred, he's probably 6 or 7 years old. And his memory was incredible. It was terribly impressive, because here's this little kid in this episode on an afternoon swimming, one of the few leisurely moments that the vice president would have in any month or year. And years later, in 1967, he would see the kid in a huge auditorium full of people with all kinds of activity going on. And he turned to him and he said, "Tommy, is that still the second best day of your life?" And that went on and on. I'm sure if they met today, Tom is 50 years old, he'd say, "Tom, is that still just the second best day of your life?" In part, he wanted to give children the best day of their life.
Ramsey, you're dealing with those years when LBJ was vice president, and it's been written and talked about so much, but would you like to give your take on the relationship between Bob Kennedy and LBJ?
Well, not necessarily like to, but I will. By that I mean, it was difficult for me. I was caught in the middle, you might say. I was caught in the middle between Bob Kennedy and J. Edgar Hoover, too, which was much tougher. I mean, Bob Kennedy would finally refuse to see the director, didn't see him, and would use Courtney Evans, an assistant director of the FBI, and me. And I don't know all the reasons or the cause, and I don't mean to be partisan in it, but because I had a duty to faithfully be the liaison between the two men, and I respected both of them, loved both of them. But it was unilateral. The president wanted the friendship of Bob Kennedy, and Bob Kennedy was not receptive. That's my... Not receptive to open friendship. Bob was focused entirely on the career of John F. Kennedy. It meant everything to him. I mean, his own tenure as Attorney General was to make John Kennedy the greatest president. And everything he did and thought was total sacrifice, really, for his brother. That's why he was so absolutely devastated when the assassination came. I mean, he didn't come back to the department in 1963, and even when he left in September to run for the Senate, he was down, really down. I mean, his spirits were... I flew up to New York with him when he accepted the nomination, which was the same day he left the Attorney Generalship. It was not possible to establish a real friendship and a real open communication, apparently because of something that happened in the 60s. I mean, I read in the books and whatnot, hear people say about something at the convention in Los Angeles or wherever it was in 1960, but perhaps it was something that happened during the Democratic primaries. Who knows? That was my perception of the truth of the relationship, the non-relationship between them, and it's a human thing. Unfortunately, it's a type of human thing that can affect history, and not helpfully, because obviously we need to communicate, don't we? And we need to seek friendship wherever it's possible. On that one, I couldn't fault Lyndon Johnson to any degree in terms of, from 1961, wanting a strong, open, friendly relationship, which he apparently had, from all that I could see, with and respect and trust of John Kennedy, who had appointed me Assistant Attorney General. You know, it's hard to describe Lyndon Johnson. His energy was almost unmatched. If a person like Thomas Edison, who said that genius is energy, was correct, or to the degree that he was correct, Lyndon Johnson must have been the greatest genius of all time, because he could give the appearance of controlling it, but I'm not sure that it was really controlled. Internally, I think maybe he was, I mean, it's legendary, but he really would call you any time of night or day, you know. He was working all the time. It didn't matter if it was 2 a.m. Monday morning or, and after he was president, perhaps he was vice president, I don't recall at the moment, he had access to the White House telephone operators, and they could find you any place. It didn't matter where you were, what time of night or day, they could find you. And they would find you. And so I'd be laying there in bed sleeping sometimes, the phone ring, the vice president, the president wants to talk to you. I think it was primarily, if not entirely, after the presidency. And be some emergency sometimes, like the Detroit race riots, or sometimes he wanted to talk about. One night I remember he called, and I was just so tired and sleepy, and I'd just gone to sleep, and it was about 2 a.m. And he sounded fresh as a daisy. He said, "I want to talk to you about the First Amendment." I was supposed to be a big champion of the First Amendment. Every time something would come up that I thought violated the First Amendment, I'd be beating the drums. He said, "I want to talk to you about the First Amendment." I said, "The First Amendment, okay." I'm trying to think, what's this, what's he talking about, you know? Well, I didn't know why he was had an interest at 2 o'clock in the morning talking about the First Amendment, but we talked about it. And sure enough, he came out with something the next day, and he said something that was, you know, glorious about the First Amendment. He loved to tease a little bit, and also he was, when he became the president. And you could talk and persuade, and 100 other people could talk and persuade, and he would make the decision, and he would reserve the decision. After the election in 64, I'd remained an assistant attorney general all those years. He called one day and he said, "I want you to come over to the White House and work for me here. I need some help until after the swearing in January." I thought, well, our department was really depleted. We'd had no attorney general since September when Bob Kennedy left to run for the Senate. And we had a whole bunch of resignations, so it was basically Nick Katzenbach and me trying to juggle all the balls of all the offices in the department. There were several people who were still there, but we lost more than half the presidential appointees. So I went over and did all kinds of odd jobs for him. I was never in speech writing or anything like that, but we were, everybody was working on the State of the Union message for that year, which was, you know, really a historic statement. I mean, he came out with all of his idealism and all of his dreams. And they were real. They were the real Lyndon Johnson that this hard-headed, practical politician was working for. And the question came up whether he should recite a line that was inspiring to some Americans and notorious to other Americans, because it was kind of the flag of the Civil Rights Movement. "We shall overcome." And I was hearing it because I had an office right next to the Oval Office, and people were coming through and arguing about it, and racing through with drafts. And, as far as I could tell, the opposition to it was absolutely unanimous. I didn't hear anybody saying he ought to say it, because the sense was that 64 had been a rocky year for civil rights, and people were getting uptight about it. But it was, anyway, and I don't think anybody knew until he gave the speech. There may have been a couple of people that saw him pencil it in, but right at the end of the speech, I think it was at the end, he said, and you could just feel him swelling, he said, "We shall overcome." I was sitting over at the White House listening, you could just feel the deflation among all of his staff. "Oh, why do you have to say that? You know, we've got to work with the Congress. We've got to work for re-election in 68 and all these other things. And here he's saying things like, 'We shall overcome,' identifying with people that have scared the country." He wanted to do it. And it was things like that that gave such absolute confidence and faith to African Americans in his presidency. One of the most moving occasions where I accompanied him to an event, which was rare, I mean, I did from time to time, but the NAACP primarily, or maybe it wasn't, maybe it was the leadership committee of the civil rights movement, which included, I remember, of course, Roy Wilkins was there, and everybody was there in the civil rights movement. And one of the Washington hotels, and there must have been 1,000 people jammed into this ballroom. And very few white faces. He had asked me to go over with him, or somebody had. I went over. And the emotion in the room was palpable. We've lost our champion. Here is a man we absolutely believe in. And here's a man who fought our battle heroically for us when there was no political advantage. After the passage of the Civil Rights Act in 64, most people thought, you know, we've done our work, that's it. And with his statement, "We shall overcome," in 65, was a statement that we have to have a Voting Rights Act. And almost uniformly, again, there were a handful of us, perhaps, in the Department of Justice that wanted it, believed it was needed, and believed it was right. But none of that mattered, because the president said, "I want you to send up a Voting Rights Act." And we had to scurry to try to create it's a fairly tough project under the Constitution of the United States, because it's a federal system, and you leave matters of qualifications of voters and things like that to the states, and that's the way it ought to be. But if the states are violating the Constitution by racial discrimination, then you got to do something. And he fought that thing through. He made the department look great, because there'd be obstacles in the Congress, and we would be up there trying to reason, and none of it would make much difference. He'd make about 5 phone calls, and he was always available. And even when you weren't initiating him, you'd find that he'd been calling Everett Dirksen and James O. Eastland and people like that, and he was making all the difference for us. So we went through to a glorious moment. The high moment of the civil rights movement, which is, to me, the noblest popular movement of the people in my time, seeking idealism and living in the legend that we had said we were, that all people were created equal, was when he signed the Voting Rights Act in the rotunda of the Capitol. A rotunda he'd walked through lots of times. And the leaders of the Big Six were there. John Lewis was there for SNCC. John Lewis is a powerful and wonderful congressman now. All the others have passed on.
when he told me, President Johnson told me one time, we're talking about the Voting Rights Act, and he said when Bobby Kennedy was still Attorney General, he had tried to convince him to sign an executive order ordering voting rights. And he said, I told him no, it wouldn't be worth the paper it was printed on. They would ignore it, and there's nothing we could do about it. He said it had to be in the law of the land. Do you recall anything about that?
I have no specific recollection. The thing I recall is that there was a big controversy, an internal fight, but it leaked out. It was in the newspapers in early 61, fairly early 61, as to whether President Kennedy should sign an executive order on public housing. Pretty natural. Public housing, I mean, who pays for it, you know? We're talking about federal housing. And you would assume that with a presidential executive order that would simply cite the 14th Amendment of the Constitution of the United States, that you could desegregate public housing. And it wasn't done. You can argue it several ways, and I think President Johnson would clearly agree, as his subsequent conduct showed, that an executive order focuses all the responsibility on the president, and to those who are emotional on the issue, it can seem despotic or extra legal. It's not. I mean, he has the power to do it within Article 2 of the Constitution. He can't just do it on any subject. He can't legislate, but in appropriate circumstances where there's federal operations, certainly within the federal government, he can say you can't discriminate on account of race, because the Constitution says so. So he's just telling his people that in faithful execution of the laws and supporting and defending the Constitution of the United States, that this is what the government has to do. But still, you just got all the responsibility then descends on one person. And if you could compare the desirability and effectiveness of legislation by the Congress, by the representatives of all the people, and a decision by an executive order by a single president, you'd say that the better course is the other way. At the time, though, there was no issue of, unless it happened in August or September, it'd have to happen in August of 64, the voting rights hadn't come up yet. The Civil Rights Act of 64 was signed, as I recall, on the 4th of July, or maybe the 2nd of July. 64, and it was a little while before, and it was Dr. King who said our next goal will be voting rights. It could be that the conversation happened after that. I don't recall it. It's also fairly unlikely to me that it did, because at that time the president had already excluded the cabinet from running on the 64 ticket with him as vice president. And Bob Kennedy did want to be the vice presidential nominee, and did feel probably very much as Lyndon Johnson felt when he gave up the majority leadership's power to be, for the splendid misery, the vice president, that he had rights to at least equity claims to. So Bob Kennedy wanted to be vice president. When that turned out, I remember Bob Kennedy came back from a meeting at the White House that day and said, well, it's all over for me in this government. That was in, I don't really remember, but say April of 64. It was the same time that the president said publicly that we need new personalities, and we need to vitalize what we're doing, and so no one in the cabinet will be, and everybody assumed it was directed at Bob Kennedy. Anyway, he went for Voting Rights Act as a matter of personal leadership and commitment. And he caused the enactment of one of the most revolutionary pieces of legislation in our history. In 1964, just as an illustration, in Mississippi, about 6.8% of the African-American population of Mississippi that was of voting age voted, under 7%. 4 years later, 1968, over 70% voted. That's a change. It's a tenfold increase. And it altered permanently what you could call the political dialogue of the state. No longer could a person like Bilbo go running for office, spout racial epithets, because his opposition could crowd him out by taking the black vote and getting enough white vote to defeat him under any, I mean, it's just a matter of counting. So everybody started talking nice, however they acted. As the years got tough, the president was a great storyteller. I thought at the time, and I've thought many times since, what a loss that we don't have him telling these stories. He would get so involved in them that I'd think, you know, I bet he enjoys telling these stories to himself, and he'd get to laughing so loud. And sometimes he'd start crying in the stories. And there's one that he repeated several times that showed that he used the stories for himself, too. And it was a story that he told about a football player in high school football in West Texas called Hardhead. And they'd struggle in a little school, a little team, but Hardhead was a spectacularly good fullback. And whenever he got in trouble, they'd just give Hardhead the ball, and he'd charge through and make a touchdown or a first down, whatever they needed. And finally, they'd gotten to the championship game, and the opposition team was about twice as big. They had a bench that was five times deeper, and these great big old blocks of granite there. And they needed a touchdown, or they were losing and or lost. And they called, give Hardhead the ball. So they gave Hardhead the ball, and he smashed into the line, and he bounced back. Second down, give Hardhead the ball. They give Hardhead the ball, and he smashes into the line, he bounces back. They give, they get in the huddle for the third down, and the quarterback sends, if they had quarterbacks, he sends for the word from the coach and said, give Hardhead the ball. And he says, Hardhead, you're going to get the ball. So the quarterback sends it. Hardhead, he don't want the ball. To me, he was feeling, if not thinking, that you want to be a champion, you know. You want to lead the team. You want to score the touchdowns. You love the glory and all of it. But sometimes nothing is possible. Sometimes it's just not something that human beings can do. And I often felt that he'd tell that story, I must have heard it three times at least, and it was always wonderful, but he would break up laughing. I mean, he would just laugh, and there'd be tears coming down his face. And he was thinking, here I've got to this thing, and I can't do it, you know.
Vietnam.
Sorry, let's cut here. We're going to do a tape change.
Okay.